Hello, everybody. I'm so excited that you guys are here with us again with Women2Women. I'm Marissa del Mar, and I'm super excited to have this human with us today. She's passionate, she's ambitious, she's thoughtful, she loves to play guitar, she loves to work out, eating healthy, she loves to spend time with her girlfriend that they actually just planted a herb garden in their balcony. She's passionate about LGBTQ plus visibility and equality, and she wants to empower young women in our community, LGBTQ plus, to recognize that we have the right to exist outside of society limiting boxes. She's also an award-winning writer, speaker, and best-selling author of The Starving Assertion, Me and Everyone is a Freak. So let's welcome to Marissa LaRocca. Marissa, thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you for that introduction.
Of course. Thank you so much for making the time and share more about you. How did it happen? What was the aha moment that you said, I want to write this and put it out there?
Okay, so for the first book, that was like a process of probably 10 years or so. I conceived of the idea to write a book while I was still in college because I had struggled with an eating disorder while I was in college. And that had a lot to do with my sexuality and just coming of age and accepting myself and all of the difficulties that go along with growing up. So by the time I was graduating college, I was already pretty much the beginning of my recovery. So I thought, I know something that I want to share with other people. I know that this eating disorder had something in it that was also my truth. Like, it's, I don't want to just call it a disorder because there's something I was searching for that's profound and powerful. And I want to find out what that is, even though I don't want to hurt myself anymore. I want to find out what that is and what my purpose is and how I can use this, what I can take from this, share, you know. So, but then I just would write a little bit and throw it all away and then write some more and throw it all away for years. And then I finally started writing seriously probably 6 years after I graduated college, and took me about 2 years to finish it. So that was the first book, and that was a whole different process. The second book I wrote, I didn't really write it, I just put it together. So that was a completely different process, and that was done in probably about 6 months. So, and the first book, Starving in Search of Me, I went with a traditional publisher. So I actually got the book deal and all of that, went through an agent and a publisher. But the second book I self-published, so that's a lot. It's a much faster process when you do it yourself. Well, most people, the world has changed so much. The world of publishing has changed so much in the last 10 years, and self-publishing has become huge. Actually, I think more books are being self-published now than traditionally published. But a lot of people still have the idea, a lot of people are not sure how the process works, or they still have the idea that if you want to be a published writer, you need to get an agent and a publisher, which you still can, but you can also upload a book to Amazon, no mm-hmm. matter who you are, and within 24 hours, it can be live. You just need to write a manuscript, format it correctly, and go into their portal and create an account and do that. And you know, it helps to hire an editor, to design yourself a good cover, or hire a designer to do these things. But I've been working for a self-publishing course for the Institute for Integrative Nutrition for a long time now. So I learned how to do all of that. So it's really easy for me to do it myself. Definitely not get stuck in perfectionism, because you know, the first book was so personal to me that I just got stuck forever trying to get it right. And that's okay when you're writing more of a memoir, because it is kind of a process of self-discovery, and it's like therapy. So it's okay to take your time. But I think that right until the day I put it out there, I felt like it wasn't done, and I'll never feel like it's done. Like, I don't even want to touch it because I will just start ripping it apart. So I think at some point you have to just let it go and realize that you can always create more work, especially in this day and age. You can always just put out a blog. If you have another idea later, don't say, oh shoot, I should have included that in my book. Like, make a video about it, or make a blog post about it, or start a new project. You know, I wrote that one book, and now that I've come out with another one, I'm like, okay, great. So I can just, I'm not going to be weighed on this one book. That's not the only thing I'll create in my life. So you have to just put stuff out there that feels sometimes not perfect, and get feedback and evolve. It's really important for the creative process, I think, to just let go and part with things.
So as a writer, what is the connection that you find in between these three things?
Between writing and health and wellness?
Yep.
Okay, I can answer that in a few different ways. It was like the, professionally, it was like the eating disorder that happened. And so I started getting into health and wellness just because I was kind of sick and trying to get better. And I was working at a health food store when I got hired by the Institute for Integrative Nutrition. And then I started working on a self-publishing course for them. So it completely looped around and went back to writing, which is what I went to college for. And I even found my agent through the Institute for Integrative Nutrition where I was working, who ended up helping me publish that book. So I don't know, serendipity has kind of worked in my favor a lot in my life. But for me personally, the connection, I just think for anyone who's trying to be creative and produce good things, it's helpful to your emotional and spiritual well-being to just take care of yourself and eat well. And if I don't exercise at least like 3 times a week, I feel crazy. So I exercise pretty religiously, like Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. I need to keep myself healthy and take care of my body. I think diversity is so important because I grew up in a very, for lack of a better word, just white Catholic school for a lot of years. And then I went to public school for high school, which was such a culture shock to me because then there was like a lot more diversity in race, and that was great. But still in high school, I didn't experience a lot of diversity in terms of like people being open about their gender and sexuality, because this was like, I don't know how many years ago I was in high school, probably like 13 or 14 years ago. And things have changed a lot. I know it's getting trendy now, but at the time, people were just not as open or questioning themselves yet. So not being exposed to different possibilities for who I could become, not only in the way of my peers, but in the way of role models and people in the media, was so damaging to me. And I think I would have spent a lot less time in my life feeling lost and confused if I had role models like that, and just more possibilities demonstrated to me. So I am really big on people not hiding who they are, because there's somebody younger than you or more closeted that needs to see you be who you are so that they can have the strength to be themselves, you know? So I really try to, in the work that I do, I try to empower people's authentic selves and to not hold back for that reason. Like my girlfriend actually says that within the LGBTQ community, a lot of people just lead with their sexuality. And she said, I don't know why people feel the need to do that. Like, straight people don't need to do that. You don't need to like walk into a room and say, I'm a lesbian, or I don't even know how I identify, but not really leading with it is almost demonstrating more by not making it a thing. You're almost setting a much better example, because every time you make it a thing and feel the need to announce it, yes, you're being seen, but you could also be someone who looks like me. Just being in the world and being myself is still saying something, you know? It's like this. And if I don't lead with that and I don't announce that, and I don't need to just hang out with people who are other LGBTQ people, you know, that's normalizing it more. Mm-hmm. So I thought that was interesting when she said that. But yeah, I also don't mind example, if somebody who seems like a younger LGBT person follows me on Instagram or something, maybe even if it's just for the way I look, okay? Maybe even if it's just for that, I don't mind, because I feel like younger people just need examples, whether it's people who are actually doing good things and saying good things in the world, but also people who just look a certain way, because that's just showing you a lifestyle that's possible for you. And I think people need that too. So definitely feel more, I don't really feel like I fit in anywhere. I feel like when I'm inside of the LGBTQ community, it's a little bit too, it can be a little bit too sexually exploitative. It can be a little bit I just feel more accepted within the community, I guess, because you can be different. You can buy whatever you want, but when I'm not in the, if I'm just in the world as a person or with people who are not LGBTQ identifying, I usually feel out of place. And that sucks because we're all people, but so I kind of feel like there's not necessarily a place for me, but I can also get along with anybody.
You need for you so you can feel that you have a place either way or whatever.
Oh yeah. Well, unfortunately, I really do feel like a lot of the damage that's done is not reversible for many of us who grew up in another time period. For me, I'm just talking about like 15 or 20 years ago, but I think that it has to start in homes and schools and what people are exposed to in the media. I really think all of that has changed a ton. So I'd be interested to learn more from people who are in like sixth grade now and what that's like compared to when I was. But I think that if so much gender stuff wasn't imposed on me when I was younger, beginning in Catholic school, with it being like there was Adam and there was Eve and they ate an apple that they shouldn't eat, and everyone's a sinner and marriage is something that should be shared between a man and a woman, and it's a sin to have sex before you're, all this taboo around sex in general, but then like it's a sin to have sex before marriage and it's definitely not even talked about if it's not between a man and a woman. And then getting into high school and all of, there's just so, if you really look for it, because I'm aware of it all the time, things are so gendered and it drives me crazy, and it's so damaging and it's so insidious. It's just part of us. I describe it sometimes as like there's, because I'll just get insecure about things and I get triggered so easily, and there's just parts of me that I can't reach at this point. Like it was just when I was developing things that just got into me. And the frustrating thing is a lot of the insecurities and triggers that I have don't even match my values. My values is that everyone deserves to express themselves the way that they want to, but I can be really triggered by, like, some of it's just such it's programming. It really just comes down to programming. We're programmed in so many ways that you can't even use logic to get yourself out of it sometimes. And if so much of that programming really went against who you are, like so much heteronormative ideals and everything just being imposed upon you, it really does damage and making you never feel like you're enough and making you feel like you don't fit anywhere. Mm-hmm. Especially, I guess, for people like me who I just feel so 50-50 in my gender, like I don't feel male or female. I guess I could identify as non-binary. I'm also fine with the term lesbian, and I go with she, her pronouns because I feel like they is too new. People are going to get it wrong, and I just don't want to deal with that. So, yeah, but it's confusing. It's confusing. I do kind of not like that word. I won't correct someone if they say it. Like if a kid says something to me and the parent goes, oh, leave the nice lady alone. I'm like, oh, no, lady, you know, I hate when people say that, but I guess I am. I'm not a man, you know, so I just would rather not be gendered. I guess maybe it's just being gendered at all that I'd rather not. I wish we just had words that were not gendered, mm-hmm. that we were all just human, and yeah. If I had grown up with examples of different kinds of women and didn't have certain things in my head of what a woman should be, if that was broader, maybe I'd feel fine. Maybe it wouldn't make me cringe, you know? So I kind of want to be that for other people by keeping the word on myself, but at the same time, it makes me cringe because of what it's always meant to me. So I don't know. I think that society is what we need to fix before we start looking at what we need to fix in ourselves. So I'm just kind of not taking a side. I'm just who I am, I guess. Thank you. I was just thinking today, like, oh, I could have called it everyone is queer also, because that would mean the same thing. I just thought about, let me just make this book real quick and see what happens. But my goal with it was, I just feel like the LGBTQ community has kind of become this container for all identities that society wants to consider alternative. And I've talked to some straight people who have some weird fetishes or just interesting sex lives or secrets. And it's like, wait a minute, that's even more queer sounding than what some people in the LGBTQ community do. I think everyone, you just don't really know what happens behind closed doors. It's very interesting. And a lot of people have desires and things that they don't even share with their partner, you know? So let alone other people. And I find that the heterosexual community tends to talk about sex less, at least in my experience, than the LGBTQ community. They just talk about it less. And I don't know if that's because they never had to confront their sexuality in the same way that people in the LGBTQ community have. Because like we had to put our sexuality under a magnifying glass and in many cases defend it. So I think that we have a different relationship with sex and sexuality in general, and many of us do more exploring than heterosexual people do. But I wanted to just bridge that gap a little bit between the LGBTQ community and the heterosexual community by coming out with this book that has perspectives from people of all genders and all sexualities and different age groups from around the US and around the world. So I wanted to just expose everybody's strangeness so that we could all just be human together and not have to divide ourselves into all these different categories. I don't think I had anyone younger than 18. I don't think I should have put anyone younger than 18 in there, even if I had submissions from them, but it spans up to like 69, and the 69-year-old man who contributed his was wonderful. Yeah, I had some really good interviews in there. Some of the more face-to-face interviews or phone interviews, and then I did online surveys for the rest.
That's so cool. Which one was the one that it just kind of like, whoa?
Yeah, I know which one that was. It was a heterosexual man, and he was in his late 50s, and he said he and his wife have sex like nobody would believe for their age, that they do it 3 times a week, that it's hours every time, and they each have like multiple orgasms during it. And he said the key is like we know how to shift power between us so that like there is no man and there is no woman. He said he feels in parts of the sexual experience that like he starts out by like dominating her, and he owns that he has like that need to dominate sometimes, but then he falls into submission and lets her dominate him. And he said I don't know if this is too graphic to say on here, but he can feel her like, I guess like having man parts, and he in his head like wants that in that moment. He just is totally using his imagination. They just shift. I read it as like they're shifting yin and yang energy between them, masculine and feminine. It really doesn't have anything to do with being a man or being a woman, but I thought it was wonderful and interesting that he was talking about how their connection goes beyond the body. It's just completely mental, and they're just shifting that power back and forth. So and he said it's the most satisfying, like amazing sex that they have, and they've been married for many years and have kids who are like grown up. And I just thought that was beautiful, and it was just so beyond gender. And he was like a straight man, and his story was the most impactful for me. Okay. So I just think it's really important to be yourself. Like that's the biggest thing. And I think that to get there, I mean, to just be authentically you at all times, and it's constantly, we're all evolving. That's okay. You don't have to know exactly who you are in every moment, but just always take care of yourself. And I think that ways people can really cultivate self-awareness, just having conversations with people that you trust, that accept you, that aren't going to judge you or make you feel bad about who you are, spending time in nature, giving yourself quiet time, and giving yourself some space throughout the day to constantly return to yourself, making sure that you have an environment that is peaceful for you and nurtures you and supports you. And I would add to like people who not only am I of an alternative gender and sexuality, but I'm also really introverted and probably highly sensitive. And I think that's just another way in which we're all diverse. People have different temperaments. And I think our culture also doesn't really nurture the softer, more sensitive personality types. We reward extroverts. There's a book called Quiet by Susan Cain, which I really recommend to anyone who's an introvert, or The Highly Sensitive Person by Elaine Aron also shaped my life a lot. And just giving me permission to be like a quiet, sensitive person, because I think it's our responsibility as quiet, sensitive people to do additional things to take care of ourselves. Like, we need more downtime than other people. We need to check in with ourselves more and be like, what do I need right now? And give that to ourselves, or we can start feeling really anxious or crazy or insecure in who we are. So we need to give, I know that I need to give myself plenty of that, you know, just to feel sane.
That's pretty amazing. And totally celebrate you, because you are here and sharing yourself by being an introvert. So.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Hey, who did you text last time and what did you say? Okay, I think I remember this. I texted my girlfriend because I was downstairs. We live in a building that kind of feels like a hotel. And I was going to go out by the pool, and I texted her to ask if she wanted to come downstairs and sit with me out there for a little bit. And she did.
Oh, that's so sweet.
Oh my God, you're playing my song.
I hope that you enjoyed this conversation with Marissa. We're going to continue dancing, and I will see you for the next one. Thank you, Marissa, for being here with us and dancing with us.